Mexico, final presentation by Annette Mago. Part 1, More Than a Border. Mexico is a vivacious country with a rich history that is tied up to the United States' past, present, and future. Most of what we hear about the land of the south of the border is from a U.S. perspective, leading the general public to have many preconceived notions that can be misguided and prejudiced. As a result, the news that reaches us usually falls under the categories of border security, immigration issues, narco trafficking, political corruption, presidential skirmishes, and probably the latest escape of El Chapo. In reality, Mexico is one of the most prosperous and powerful countries in Latin America and has a lot to offer. Like many countries in Latin America, however, it has many obstacles to overcome left over from a bloody and complicated history. Mexico is the third largest country in Latin America and the country that is home to the biggest population of Spanish speakers in the world, which is the majority of its population of over 124 million people. The Mexican economy is the second largest in Latin America and the 13th largest exporter in the world, with 80% of its exports going into the United States. Mexico's diverse ecosystem can range from tropical landscapes to coastal paradises to arid deserts and attract millions of tourists every year. One of the country's biggest industries is tourism, which flocks thousands of Mexico's major cities like Mexico City, the capital of Mexico, and one of the largest cities in Latin America, with a population of 8 million people, as well as Cancun, Guadalajara, Oaxaca, and Tijuana. It's easy to see what draws thousands of tourists every year. Mexico's rich historic landmarks, delicious traditional food, and amicable people make the country an alluring travel destination. The Mexican population is primarily made up of mestizos, or people with indigenous and Spanish European ancestry. Over 95% of people speak Spanish, and most of the population practices Roman Catholicism. This religion was brought over by the Spaniards during the conquest of the Americas and was secured among the indigenous population of Mexico with the introduction of the Virgen de Guadalupe, who was a mestizo virgin. The mixture of indigenous and European cultures and customs gradually cultivated a unique Mexican identity, which formed its own distinct traditions that are still active today, such as the famous Día de los Muertos. Mexican culture is one of the most visible representations of Latin American culture in global media. Unfortunately, a lot of that representation circulated in the English-speaking world is highly stereotyped. In actuality, Mexico has historically been one of the richest centers of artistic expression in Latin America. It is a leader in many art industries full of famous fine artists, musicians, architects, actors, directors, comedians, and of course, telenovelas. Comics such as Cantinflas and El Chapulín Coloreado that are ingrained in the fabric of Latin American identity originated from Mexico. World-renowned fine artists such as Frida Kahlo, Diego Rivera, and José Orozco were born out of Mexico, especially in the aftermath of the Mexican Revolution due to the rise of Mexican muralism. Famous Latin American musicians and directors such as Selena, Guillermo del Toro, who was recently directed The Shape of Water, and Jorge Gutierrez, who directed The Book of Life. Mexico has come a long way to become the country that it is in the present day. Its history is filled with the same story that plagues many Latin American countries, a history of conquest and slavery of Afro and indigenous peoples. Mexico had a long pre-Hispanic story filled with advanced Mayan and Aztec civilizations among other indigenous groups, the majority of which had been erased with the implementation of European imperialism, starting with the conquistador Hernán Cortés, who took advantage of the Aztec king Montezuma's confusion of Cortés for one of the Aztec gods by using that misconception to ultimately conquer the Aztec Empire. From there, the Catholic Church and the Spanish monarchy both had a connected presence that worked to assimilate and subdue a rapidly declining indigenous population. The viceroyalty that had developed after extensive colonization set up a highly classist and racist society dictated by connection to European descendants. Around the 1800s, this system was overthrown by the Mexican-American War, and since then, Mexico had gained independence from Spain. After independence, however, a lot of remaining Spanish-Mexican aristocrats remained in control that resulted in a power struggle between the Mexican Empire and the Republican ideals of the Congress. In 1824, the Mexican Congress had created the Constitution, which was the first big step in the country's history as a republic. Unfortunately, this early in the republic's infancy, the country had already been dealing with major territorial disputes from its titanic neighbor in the north. Manifest Destiny had encouraged American settlers to move west into many areas that were already Mexican settlements. Eventually, large chunks of Mexican territory would be taken into the U.S. border. Less than a century later, the Mexican Revolution would mark another major shift in the political climate. The common aim of the revolution was to unseat the Diaz dictatorship which had taken over Mexico. This led to years of tumultuous unrest, even after the dictatorship had been overthrown, that led well into the mid-20th century. With presidential guidance, the republic eventually stabilized and began growing economically during World War II, with the beginning of large trade agreements with the United States. Since then, Mexico's economy had slowly but surely grown and making Mexico one of the most developed countries in Latin America, despite the government being plagued with notorious corruption scandals in the highest levels of office. Even though Mexico is still very much in progress with its own issues that need urgent remedy, such as the rising pollution levels in Mexico City, infrastructure, instability, political corruption, discrimination against race, gender, and class, rising immigration levels, narco-trafficking, and most recently, earthquake relief. Part 2, Problems in Mexico Today. This year, one of the biggest elections in Mexican history will take place. 9 out of the 32 states will elect their governors, 972 seats of state legislators will be contested, and 1,612 municipalities and mayoralities will have executive elections. During the 2018 general elections at the federal level, the highest office in the nation, that of the President of the Republic, will be highly contested with an increasing anti-American sentiment simmering in Mexico in reaction to the Trump administration's indelicate remarks against the Mexican public. President Nieto's steady relationship with the United States has greatly lowered public opinion of him. The next elected president may have different implications for political relations with the United States in the current political climate. A new development in Mexican politics is that for the first time, Mexican independent candidates can be part of the Mexican presidential ballot without having major party affiliations. U.S. intervention in Mexico, the Mérida Initiative. The new president could potentially have a big impact in the way that narco-trafficking is being prosecuted in Mexico. As drug cartels begin to form in urban centers all over Mexico, its number one consumer begins to take preventative action against it by declaring a war on drugs. When Calderón becomes president of Mexico in 2006, 8 days into his term, he declares war on the cartels and launches a security program that is heavily supported by the United States to identify and eradicate these cartels, and especially their leaders. The United States spent $2.3 billion collectively through the Mérida Initiative, as well as security training and personnel for a system that was corrupt on every level, despite its abundant funds. Since the initiation of this program, most of the drug cartel kingpins have been killed, extradited to the U.S., or jailed. However, these accomplishments pale in comparison to the amount of bloodshed that occurred as a result. The cartels, although missing their leaders, do not disappear so much as fracture off into smaller and more violent groups. When Peña Nieto took office in 2012, his rhetoric in relation to the drug war was muted and evasive, and more focused on diplomatic efforts to attract foreign investors. However, under Nieto, the Meritive Initiative have been more active than ever. There were 63,000 people murdered in the first half of Nieto's term, 50% more than the casualties that occurred in Calderón's first 3 years. Femicide in Paradise. One of Mexico's most popular tourist states, Quintana Roo, has been under some much-needed scrutiny regarding a recent trend in highly visible gender-based violence. In 2015, a series of 18 horrific murders against Mexican women were committed, seven being committed within 3 weeks. This femicide, as it has been called, has sparked mass protests of people who are outraged by the lack of investigation into these murders by government officials. Officials are hesitant to allow deeper investigations for fear that it will affect tourism in the state. These incidents represent a larger problem of gender-based violence, and more alarmingly, the indifferent attitudes towards violence towards women in Mexican government institutions.
Que se tiene hacia la mujer es de todas. Mujeres, tenemos que apoyarnos, porque si no lo hacemos entre nosotras mismas, ¿quién lo va a hacer?
¡Se renuncia, Peña!
Pues no solo son los 43 estudiantes, sino también las miles de desaparecidas, las muertas, las violadas.
Organizaciones campesinas e indígenas.
Les vuelvo a dar las gracias.
La juventud es el que mueve al mundo. Tiene que ser la que dé el cambio. La que dé el cambio en el país.
Sentación con vida y castigo a los culpables.
Part 3, the bigger picture. Mexicans suffer many of the same obstacles that many other Latin American countries had to face. Overcoming the colonizing forces that had subdued the general public, forging a new identity out of the clash of cultures from two completely different worlds, and rallying around and then suffering the tyrannical rule of power-hungry caudillos that take advantage of their support. Every country has a different story. But much like the Campbell's Heroes journey model, they all follow a similar path despite the variances. However, the specific experiences that Mexicans have gone through as a people is what forms the famous Mexican identity that we all have come to be familiar with one way or another. Because of this project, I was able to investigate something that has always interested me about Latinx representation in the United States and the world. The few times that I saw Latinos in the media growing up, I never personally connected with them. As a kid, for me, a Latin American identity didn't really exist. It was the Latinos that I saw on TV, which were primarily based on Mexicans, and then there was my family living in our South Floridian bubble. Later, I became aware of the massive population of Mexican immigrants and descendants as the largest Hispanic presence in the United States. After that, I began noticing how Mexican media and art had permeated the social cultures of many other countries. For example, my dad talking about watching El Chapulín Colorado on TV on the weekends as a kid in Venezuela, and the image of Frida Kahlo being recognized in countries all over the world. This course has helped me build my knowledge about Latin America as a whole, and has helped me create a greater understanding of the identities of the people and systems that inhabit.